respiratory gases. So we know that the respiratory gases are oxygen and carbon dioxide. So if we see here the oxygen and carbon dioxide, the cells present in our body require constant supply of oxygen. Why the cells require constant supply of oxygen? Because for the oxidation of food materials, that means to carry out the metabolism, right? The cells require constant supply of oxygen, and at the same time, due to metabolic effect, the cells also release the carbon dioxide. So which is supplying or which is transporting these gases now? Let us see. This is the alveoli. This is the alveoli. So during inspiration, we inspire oxygen, right? And this oxygen diffuses into the blood. So if you see the medium of transport, the medium of transport is blood. Okay, so the blood is transporting oxygen from the alveoli of lungs to, what are these? These are the cells, right? So the blood is transporting the oxygen from alveoli of lungs to the cells, right? And the cells are releasing the carbon dioxide. And this carbon dioxide again transported by blood to the alveoli of lungs for their elimination. You understand? So the medium of transport is blood. Blood transports the oxygen from alveoli of lungs to the cells, and the carbon dioxide produced by the cells due to metabolic activity is transported by again blood to the alveoli of lungs for their elimination. So let us see the transport of oxygen now. Oxygen is transported by blood, as I told you earlier. So if you see the blood consists of right. In the blood we can see the presence, the blood consists of two components. One is the plasma and one is the second one is the blood cells. But we see here the solubility of oxygen is very less. The solubility of oxygen is very less in the fluids. So how much of oxygen is transported by plasma and how much of oxygen is transported by blood cells? Here the blood cells means, remember that we are not going to discuss about all the blood cells, but we are going to discuss about only the RBC. Because in the blood cells, RBC is the second thing that transports the oxygen. Now again, let us go for the diffusion of gas. Just I will explain there how much it is transporting there. Okay, this is the alveoli of lung and this is the blood vessel, right? So during inspiration, oxygen enters into the alveoli of lung. Okay, from the alveoli of lung, the oxygen diffuses into the blood. So this is the blood. So in the blood, what are the components of blood means? We see here, this is the plasma, this is the plasma and this is the RBC. Okay. So how much of, I told you that the solubility of oxygen in the fluids is very less. So only 3% of oxygen is transported in a dissolved state in plasma. So by plasma, how much of oxygen is transported now? Only 3%. Why only 3%? Because the solubility of oxygen in the fluids is very less. So as the solubility of oxygen in the fluids is very less, only 3% of oxygen is transported. Right. Then what happened to the remaining 97%? By RBC. Right. So this is the RBC. Then how much of oxygen is transported by RBC means 97%. 97% of oxygen is transported by RBC. That means what the RBC contain? In the RBC, which are carrying these oxygen molecules? If you see here, in the RBC, we can see hemoglobin. Okay, in the RBC, we can see these are the hemoglobin molecules. So, how many hemoglobin molecules are present? There are millions of hemoglobin molecules. Millions of hemoglobin molecules are present in each RBC. So, how many means? Nearly we can expect around 250 to 300 millions of hemoglobin is present in each RBC. Then we see what is the hemoglobin. Hemoglobin is a respiratory pigment, right? A red color pigment, and it is a conjugate protein. Then we see the structure of hemoglobin. Hemoglobin is a tetramer. Tetramer. That means it is made up of with four polypeptides. Hemoglobin is a tetramer and it is made up of with four polypeptides. So let us see what are those four polypeptides. Two alpha, two beta chains. Okay. Then if you see the structure, the hemoglobin consists of, these are the globin. The hemoglobin consists of heme plus globin. The hemoglobin consists of heme plus globin. So, how many polypeptides are there? Means there are four polypeptides. 1, 2, 3, 4. And each polypeptide contains one heme group. Each polypeptide contains one heme group. Right? In each polypeptide, there is one heme group. So, this is the heme group. You understand that? How many polypeptides are there in one hemoglobin? Four. There are four polypeptides. Each polypeptide contains how many heme groups? Each polypeptide contains one heme. Then one hemoglobin molecule contains how many heme groups? Four. Right. See here. Each So, let us see again here, each polypeptide consists of one heme group. Each heme group can bind to one oxygen molecule. Each heme group can bind to one oxygen molecule. So, if we see how many hemes are here, 1, 2, 3, 4. One hemoglobin carries how many oxygen molecules now? 4 oxygen molecules. Why? Because each hemoglobin molecule contains 4 heme groups and each heme can carry one oxygen molecule. So, one hemoglobin carries how many oxygen molecules means 4 oxygen molecules. Let us see. Hb plus 4O2 is called as Right. So oxygen always binds with hemoglobin in a reversible manner. So binding of oxygen with hemoglobin is called as oxygenation. Where oxygenation of hemoglobin occurs? Oxygenation of hemoglobin occurs inside the lungs. Okay. Now let us see how much of oxygen is carried. How much of oxygen is carried in the 100 ml of blood? Let us see now that one also. Binding of oxygen occurs in the lungs. That means oxygenation takes place in the lungs. Then where does the dissociation takes place? Dissociation of oxygen occurs in the tissues. Okay. Then 1 gram of hemoglobin can carry 1.34 milliliters of oxygen. Then on an average, 100 ml of blood contains how much of hemoglobin? Of blood consists of 13 to 16 grams of hemoglobin. That is, average is around 15 grams. Then 15 grams of hemoglobin carries how much ml of ml of oxygen? Let us see now. So 15 into 1.34, that is equal to 20.1. But remember that oxygen, the 100 ml of blood always carry 19.4 ml of oxygen. Why? 100 ml of blood is always carrying 19.4 ml of oxygen means, remember that oxygen, the hemoglobin is not completely saturated. I told you there are millions of hemoglobin molecules and each hemoglobin molecule can carry 4 oxygen molecules. But in that millions of molecules, some, very few, may carry 3 oxygen molecules. So we cannot say that 100% the hemoglobin is saturated. So as we know that only 97% of hemoglobin is saturated, so we can say that 100 ml of blood can carry only 19.4 ml of oxygen. Right. So 100 ml of blood very important point this one 100 ml of blood can deliver 5 ml of oxygen to the tissues. Okay. Then 100 ml of deoxygenated blood can carry 14.4 ml of oxygen. Okay. Then why you are calling, which one is called as deoxygenated blood? Right. So this is the tissue. So this is the blood vessel. So oxygen is diffuses into the tissues due to low partial pressure in the tissues. And at the same time, so from here, carbon dioxide diffuses into the blood. When carbon dioxide enters into the blood, we call that one as deoxygenated blood. Remember that. Dear students, let us continue now. Oxygen dissociation curve. So what is oxygen dissociation curve? Oxygen dissociation curve explains the relationship between the partial pressure of oxygen and percentage saturation of hemoglobin. So oxygen dissociation curve is a sigmoid curve. Let us see that one. So the curve looks like this. Why it is sigmoid curve? Why? Because the affinity of hemoglobin towards oxygen is very less. As I told you that, if you see here, this is the structure of hemoglobin. Okay. Binding of oxygen to hemoglobin is very difficult. In the first phase, we see here, first, the one oxygen molecule binds to hemoglobin, right? So remember here, this is the one oxygen molecule, one O2. So binding of oxygen to hemoglobin is very difficult because the affinity is very less. Then how this oxygen binds to the hemoglobin? Binding of oxygen to the hemoglobin depends upon the partial pressure. If the pressure increases, oxygen binds to the hemoglobin. So depending upon the pressure, the binding of oxygen occurs to the hemoglobin. So once one oxygen molecule binds to hemoglobin, then the remaining hemoglobin molecules easily binds to this one. So that is the reason why the oxygen dissociation curve is sigmoid. See here, this is very difficult. Here there is no oxygen, so it is very difficult. So due to some pressure, it is binding here one oxygen molecules. Once the one oxygen molecule is binded here, it is giving a way to bind with the remaining oxygen molecule. So it is going steep like this, and after that it becomes saturated completely due to binding of four oxygen molecules. After four oxygen molecules binds, then there is no binding of oxygen molecules here. You understand that? So first one oxygen molecules bind. After binding to one oxygen molecules, it is giving way to the remaining oxygen molecules to bind here. Then it is forming completely saturated here. Let us see how many oxygen molecules are binding, then how it is forming now. Okay, let us see here. So we are plotting a graph on the regarding the oxygen dissociation curve. So on x-axis we are taking partial pressure of oxygen, and on y-axis we are taking percentage saturation of hemoglobin, right? So this is a normal hemoglobin dissociation curve. So generally it is a normal hemoglobin dissociation curve. Where this normal hemoglobin dissociation curve is formed? This is formed in the lungs, right? So what is the conditions for the formation of oxyhemoglobin curve? The conditions for the formation of oxyhemoglobin curve is more partial pressure of oxygen, less partial pressure of carbon dioxide, temperature is low, and pH is more. That means H plus ion concentration is less. So remember that oxyhemoglobin dissociation curve, that means oxygenation takes place in the lungs. I am not satisfied with this topic. Let us go for the formation of oxyhemoglobin. So this is the curve like this. So this is the x-axis, this is the y-axis. This is partial pressure of oxygen. This is the partial percentage saturation of hemoglobin. So, where does the oxyhemoglobin is formed? Oxyhemoglobin is formed in the lungs. Oxyhemoglobin is formed in the lungs. So, what are the conditions for the formation of oxyhemoglobin? The conditions for the formation of oxyhemoglobin is high partial pressure of oxygen, low partial pressure of carbon dioxide, so the conditions are high partial pressure of oxygen, low partial pressure of carbon dioxide, low temperature, pH is high, that means H plus ion concentration is very less, right? So let us see here. So this one takes place in the lungs. So this is the normal oxyhemoglobin curve. Okay, now let us see where the dissociation of oxyhemoglobin occurs. Oxyhemoglobin dissociation occurs in the tissues. Okay, now let us see. Like this, at 100 mmHg, the hemoglobin is 97% saturated. Right? At 100 mmHg, the hemoglobin is 97% saturated. So, where this occurs, 97% of saturation occurs, where means inside the lungs. Then what happens in the tissues? In the tissues, if we see in the tissues, the partial pressure of oxygen is less. When the partial pressure of oxygen is less, what happens? The curve slightly shifts towards the right side. The curve is shifting towards the right side. That means how much? So this is at 40 mmHg. The percentage saturation of hemoglobin is 75%. So the curve is shifting towards the right side. Then, if you go for the skeletal muscles, that is at 20 mmHg. So at 20 mmHg, what is happening? At 20 mmHg, it is around 35% saturated. Right? So what are the factors that are responsible for the dissociation of oxyhemoglobin curve? Let us see. High carbon dioxide concentration, high H plus concentration, high temperature, low pH is less and PO2 is less. You remember here, the dissociation of oxyhemoglobin occurs in the tissues due to concentration of PCO2. Remember here, if the carbon dioxide concentration increases, it reduces the affinity of hemoglobin towards the oxygen. So this is called as Bohr effect. This is called as Bohr effect. So what does the Bohr effect say? The Bohr effect states that increased carbon dioxide concentration, H plus ion concentration, reduces the affinity of hemoglobin towards oxygen. So the oxygen binding capacity reduces if the carbon dioxide concentration and H plus ion concentration is increasing in the blood. So this is about the dissociation of the oxyhemoglobin. Now let us see how the saturation takes place. Right, I'll explain this one in the tabular form, how the dissociation is taking place. Now I'm going for the location. Let us see in the location. Location is lungs. At lungs, what is the partial pressure of oxygen? 97%. PO2 is 100 mmHg. Yeah. Huh. Partial bed of oxygen is 100 mmHg. Saturation of hemoglobin is 97%. 4 oxygen molecules, 0. See here. Location is lungs. In the lungs, what is the partial pressure of oxygen? At the lungs, the partial pressure of oxygen is 100 mmHg. At 100 mmHg, what is the percentage saturation of hemoglobin? 97%. Then, on an average, each hemoglobin molecule carries how much of oxygen? 4. Then, how much of oxygen is given away by hemoglobin? Means 0. Right? We go for the tissues at rest. So, what is the partial pressure of oxygen at tissues at rest? Means it is around 40 mmHg. Right? At 40 mmHg, how much oxygen, how much percentage of saturation takes place in the hemoglobin? The percentage saturation of hemoglobin at 40 mmHg is 75%. Then how much of oxygen is carried out? Then percentage of oxygen unloaded at the tissues when at the rest means, let us see. It is around 22%. Now if we go for the next one. This is the skeletal muscle. In the skeletal muscle, what is the partial pressure of oxygen? The partial pressure of oxygen in the skeletal muscle is 20 mmHg. Then, what is the percentage saturation of hemoglobin in the skeletal muscle? It is 35%. Then, how much oxygen is carried out by hemoglobin means? It is 2 oxygen molecules. Then, how much oxygen is unloaded here? We see here, 97 minus 35, that equal to 62%. So more oxygen is unloaded in the skeletal muscle. So this completes about the oxygen dissociation curve. Thank you.